Hey guys, Nary here from Jakewing Gamers, if you know me out on Twitter, The Gaming Dragon. Today I'm coming right back at you with a new Let's Play episode of Temptation's Ballad. So, several of you were telling me I'm probably going to have to do a lot of editing for this. I'm fine with that. I've got a lot of creative little sensor bars that I can use to, play around with certain scenes. But, yeah. Alright, so guys, let's just jump right back in. Please sit back and enjoy for the next 18 minutes and let's go. Arm tenure up. Alright, let's do it. Okay. I'll fake it till I make it somehow. Lying to Papa feels better than disappointing him. If Mero's ego was truly that fragile, I'd smack him out of this guild myself. Go talk to your father, Cole. He loves you dearly, magic or otherwise. I'm sure he'll understand. Yeah, sure, and I'll be the next king of Axia, Cole thought to himself as he stomped past Amish with a huff. The wooden floors creaked as the older hyena turned to follow him. Guy's worse than a mother hen. I gotta get out of here. Cole glanced up with a smirk. Speaking of uncomfortable conversations, when are you gonna start officially courting Papa for real? Just wanna brace myself in case I come home to an official second dad. Ha! Whatever calm collectedness Hamish held immediately collapsed as his face erupted into a harsh red hue. Excuse me? That's none of your business! Cole smirked as he shoved past the spluttering hyena. I'm just saying, maybe once you're officially my papa number two, I'll actually listen to your nonsense. Anyway, ta-ta, I've got an adventuring job to warm myself out of. And with that, Cole stomped out the door and left a spluttering Amish behind. Alright, where are we going? Ah, yes, the Market District, Sparrow's Roost, Inn and Tavern. Ooh. Well, that's pretty. Meanwhile, across the city at an actual functioning tavern, a young badger slumped his way home with heavy shoulders and an even heavier heart. Oh god, he's cute! Sid Shrikewood's face was grim as he stumbled home to the tavern that his mother ran, returning home empty-handed yet again. And this time he returned bright and early in the morning. The day had barely begun, with cool morning dew settling on the wet grass below. As Sid approached the steps of Sparrow's Roost Inn and Tavern, his eyes lit up at the sight of a familiar face waiting for him. Which sort of voice should I do for Sid? Guys, let me know in the comments. For now, I'm just going to go with one of my other normal voices. Hey, Betsy! How's business at the tavern going today? Hope the customers have been treating you well. Sid sighed and plopped down on a large stone next to his longtime friend. As for me, well, the morning just started and it's already a shit day. He buried his face in his hands. Got kicked out of my scribe apprenticeship. Third day on the job! That's gotta be a new record. Mom's gonna kill me at this rate. What am I supposed to tell her? Sid shook his head and grabbed a nearby broom lying next to the Sparrow's Roost Inn's entrance. He absentmindedly began sweeping the dirt and grime off the tavern steps. Rhythmic chores always helped him clear away dreadful thoughts. The chores also helped relieve some extra work from his mother's already massive workload, which was always a plus. Sid's mother was always working, bustling about in the tavern and serving customers day and night. His heart lurched painfully in his chest when he returned home every night to see her slumped over a chair in exhaustion. Her hands had grown coarse with calluses, and she has complained of back pain as of late. And naturally, Sid often showed up at the Sparrow's Roost and Inn Tavern to help out whenever he could, usually because he got kicked out of yet another apprenticeship job. Sid sighed and paused his sweeping to look down at Betsy. She silently stared back at him, ever the good listener. Hey, Betsy, this is like the fifth apprenticeship I got fired from. I really want to make Mom happy and get a cushy job, but none of this feels right for me, you know? Betsy's gonna be like a dog or something. An amused chuckle left Sid's throat as he tried to imagine himself as a scribe. Me? Cooped up in a cushy commoner job? I mean, I'm a commoner through and through, but I always dreamed of being something bigger, you know? Sorry, guys. Sid twirled the broom in with his practiced swings, slashing at the air enthusiastically as though it were a sword. Oh! Oh! Now, Sid the Adventurer, that rolls off the tongue way better. That was actually a really cool animation. Going out to the world to perform heroic deeds, amassing glory and saving the day like the champions in storybooks. What do you think, Betsy? Yeah, oh my god. Ribbit! Betsy, as usual, did not answer for the simple fact that she was a toad. Ever the good listener, she continued staring up at Sid with deep, understanding eyes as she perched on her usual basking rock. Right? And make a fantastic adventurer. And bards will sing of my legend one day, just you watch. Hey-ya! Ha-ha! Sid swung his broomsword in the air with wild and brash sweeps. He imagined fending off an invisible foe as he jabbed and thrusted his heroic weapon to and fro. Hiya! Take that! Whoops! His foot suddenly slipped on wet cobblestone and he tumbled forward with the grace of a damp log. As Sid stumbled, he lost his grip on his very heroic broomsword and yelped as it soared into the air, right as the tavern doors creaked open. Aww. She's adorable. Is that his mom?
Sid, dear, are you...
Ow!
Ouch!
Sid's mother winced as a flying broom handle smacked her right between the ass. Wait, is she a bird? Surprised he doesn't have more avian features. Maybe he does, and we're just not seeing it. Maybe he's got tail feathers. Mom! Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry! I didn't mean to... He rushed to his mom's side as she gingerly rubbed her bruised forehead. Ilya looked up at her son with an exasperated yet fond smile as she pinched his cheeks.
It's quite all right, dear. Your mother is made of tougher stuff than this. Were you pretending to be a sword fighter with the broom again? Because the windows were open and the whole tavern could hear and see you.
What? They saw? Sid's ears flattened against his head as he flushed pink. That was a private conversation!
With your frog?
Ilya glanced down at Betsy, doubtfully. Excuse you? Betsy is a noble toad and a good friend. Sid watched as his mother sighed deeply and buried her face in her hands. It looked like she was doing her best to keep a straight face and avoid chuckling. Or crying. Sid couldn't tell at this point.
Oh, sweetheart. I heard your, conversation earlier. Were you fired from your apprenticeship again?
Sid's shoulders slumped as he stared anywhere but his mother's prying eyes. Well, fired is a strong word. I prefer the term gently let go.
Of course, dear.
He felt a gentle wing on his arm. Sid glanced down. His mom looked so tiny in comparison.
The scribe, the blacksmith, even the wood furnishers. You've been let go from practically every apprenticeship job in our neighborhood. Sweetheart, I may not be as charismatic as your frog friend here, but please don't be afraid to speak to me if something's wrong.
Nothing's wrong. Well, kinda. Guilt started creeping through his chest. They've been through this conversation countless times. I just can't get into any of these ordinary jobs. The thoughts of getting stuck indoors as a scribe for the rest of my life feels miserable. I just want to go out there and see the world. Don't you want your son to succeed as a great and glorious adventurer? I know I have it in me to be somebody instead of another commoner out in the market district. Somebody great! Ilya's grip on his arm tightened as worried trepidation filled her face.
Oh, Sid, I know this is difficult, but... The reason your father and I work ourselves to the bone day in and day out is because we hope to create a better future for you. We work so hard because we hope you don't have to. I want you to be happy as well, but many adventurers often don't return home. The thought of you going out into the world alone...
Ellie snapped her beak shut, shivering. Oh, Mom, don't worry. I'm the toughest cookie around. Are you really never going to let me be an adventurer? Ever? The Adventurer's Guild is just a short walk away in the Marauders District. It's so close I can practically taste it.
I suppose.
Yes! Is that a yes?
No.
Ilya sighed as Sid emotionally deflated like a trampled balloon.
Oh, don't give me those sad puppy eyes. Your father and I had a long talk this morning and we came to a decision.
She took a deep breath.
If you're going to go out doing wildly dangerous adventuring jobs, it would be a great comfort to your father and I if you had trusted friends by your side. If you had a few dependable friends to form an adventuring party with, I suppose you could go talk to the Adventuring Guild.
Sid perked up and then immediately groaned. Bold of you to assume I have friends in general. People always laugh at me.
Well, perhaps if you stop talking to your frog all the time.
Betsy is a toad! Ilya sighed with a defeated smile and patted her son on the shoulder. This was impressive, considering she could barely reach it even when standing on her tiptoes.
All right, dear. Why don't you get out of here while the day is still young? Go mingle about the Marauders District and see if you can make any friends. Oh, and before I forget, I packed you some snacks in case you get hungry later. Be sure to share them with your friends if you make them later today.
Sid stood, stunned while his mother stuffed several wrapped sandwiches into his tiny pockets. Wait, you're really giving me a chance? Thank you so much, Mom! I won't disappoint you!
You never do. I love you, sweetheart.
Oh, Sid was already prancing halfway down the street, practically vibrating with excitement. Love you too, Mom!
Oh, and if you don't manage to find anyone for your adventuring party, your father's looking for an assistant at his cheese shop. And he's gone.
Illy clasped her hands together and tried to ignore the anxious knot tugging at her chest. She looked down at Betsy, croaking happily in a rock.
Oh, wise frog, what do you think? What are the chances my son comes back a wiser and more sensible young man?
Ribbit! Illy sighed.
I thought so.
Where are we going now? Are we going to go meet that paladin or that knight, whatever he is? Church District, Grand Cathedral. Okay, so we're meeting our characters. Ooh. That sword looks familiar. The Grand Cathedral stood coldly against the morning air, the sun's harsh rays reflecting off its bright walls like jagged knives. Most of the inhabitants of the Grand Cathedral had already left the main hall to perform their daily duties, save one. A lone knight stood solid in an empty corner of the hall, her sword and shield drawn ready at her side.
Oh, girl, okay.
She thought she looked rather masculine. Tomboyish, I should say. Yeah, I could see it now. Her blade glinted off the morning sun in precise swings. Her stance and posture were as picture-perfect as they were rigid and anxious. Artemi Johanna Gautier resumed her daily training as a holy knight of the church, as she had done every day as far as she could remember. Her blade hand paused as cheerful voices echoed from one of the cathedral's side entrances. Bishop Katrina glided elegantly into the main hall with a half-dozen church youths following closely behind like a flock of ducklings. She carried a commanding presence as she directed the youths to their duties.
The floors on the side halls will need a thorough sweeping along with the entirety of the east wing staircase. Understood?
The church youths mumbled but nodded quietly. At the sight of the bishop, Artemy hastily sheathed her sword and bowed deeply. Bishop Katrina barely spared her a glance. A few of the church youths suddenly noticed her and stared.
Hello.
Artemy gave the small crowd a shy little wave. Most of the youths sneered and scrunched their noses. Several whispered amongst each other with less than kind words. Why? Did she have a reputation? Artemy dropped her hand back to her side dejectedly.
Why is she even here? All that little mutt ever does is pretend to swing her sword around the cathedral all day while the rest of us do all the hard work. And she's not even a real knight! Talk about unfair!
Bishop Petrina's heels clicked sharply on the cathedral's stone floor as she turned towards them.
Whispering is quite rude, children.
The whole group bowed their heads apologetically. One of the older youths glanced up defiantly.
Apologies, Your Excellency. We were just a little curious.
Yes, it appears many of you are ignorant of certain important topics. You all surely know of the Creator's Chosen.
Ooh. Pretty sword.
Throughout history, our great Creator has chosen champions worthy of her holy light to protect the Church from the evils of this world. It is prophesied that each Chosen will play an important role in guarding the world from destruction. Our Artemy is one such Chosen. On the night of her birth, they say a beam of celestial light descended from the heavens above and blessed Artemy of the Creator's holy strength. That is why she carries such powerful celestial magic within her veins. One day, when the Chosen reaches her full potential, she'll be able to draw the Creator's holy blade from the pedestal and deliver the world from a terrible fate. Until that time comes, she's to continue training under the guidance of the Church.
A few of the church youths snickered to themselves as they glanced at Artemy standing awkwardly in a corner of the main hall.
But Your Excellency, how does the Creator choose her champions? Of all people, why was she chosen?
Bishop Petrina either did not notice the disdain of the youth's voice or decided to ignore it.
We simple mortals cannot hope to fathom the will and intent of our Creator. We can only have faith that she chose well. Now, enough idle chatter. Move along to your duties, all of you.
The half-dozen youths nodded politely and scrambled out of the hall. A heavy silence descended upon the cathedral. Bishop Katrina turned towards Artemy's corner of the room. Artemy gulped and straightened her posture.
Good morning, Mother. Daughter.
Artemy felt her mother regard her coldly. She could never tell whether she was pleased or disappointed by something. When it came to herself, it was usually the latter.
You relate to your swordsmanship practice this morning, so I heard.
Artemy winced and bowed her head.
Yes, but only by a few minutes. That is no excuse. You are the chosen one. The world has higher expectations of you than that of a mere knight. My apologies, Your Excellency. I will do better next time. You say that so often, and yet...
Dread crept through Artemis' chest as her mother sighed and rubbed her temples.
In any case, I saw that note you left at my door this morning. You wish to speak with me? Yes, mother!
Her heart thumped rapidly against her chest. Artemis inhaled and tried desperately to steady her breath. She never felt comfortable while speaking, especially to her mother.
Your Excellency, I have been diligently training within the Grand Cathedral since I was a mere child to prepare for my role as the Creator's Chosen. But throughout all these years, I have rarely the opportunity to leave the walls of the cathedral, and not once have I stepped foot outside the church district. I understand the church...
One second, guys. I got a hair in my eye. Get out of my eye, hair!
Alright. I understand that the church feels this is the best for my safety, but with no experience of the outside world, I feel very ill-prepared for my duty. That is why,
No. Oh, nice. Artemis nervously saluted and bowed.
Your Excellency, I humbly request for a small task or mission outside of the church district.
No. Bishop Katrina's reply was immediate. Artemis flinched, completely taken aback.
Huh? May I ask why?
Artemis gulped as Bishop Katrina stepped close. She circled around her like a predator, wearing a cold, harsh glare.
Look at you. You know what I see?
Flaws. Nothing but flaws. Horrible, cowardly posture for a knight.
You can barely even speak without falling apart like a nervous child. Why, mere minutes ago, I witnessed you being too intimidated to even strike a conversation with the church youths. Don't even get me started on your training.
Bishop Katrina leaned forwards until her face was just inches away.
Artemis Johanna Gautier, from what I have seen, you are without a doubt the weakest chosen one throughout all of history.
Her words pierced Artemis' chest like cold daggers. The young knight took a deep breath in a futile effort to steady herself.
Do you wish to take on a mission outside the church and become the laughingstock of the entire city?
I don't think so.
Stay in the church, continue your training, and do as you are told. Lest you bring more embarrassment to the church in our family name, daughter. But... I must take on missions if I'm going to gain experience and improve! You're not even close to ready, and you know it. But... Are you going to continue such an uncouth argument here, in public, right in the middle of the main hall? This is exactly why you're not fit to leave the cathedral yet.
That's better. We simply want what's best for you, daughter.
Oh, is this a bad time?
Whoa! Big dude. The two of them immediately glanced up to see a large polar bear clad in high-ranking church armor approaching them with a jolly grin. Artemis immediately saluted.
Knight Commander Gronk! Good morning to you, sir!
Bishop Katrina simply gave the polar bear a polite nod. Gronk laughed jovially and patted Artemis on the shoulder.
It is a fine morning indeed. I hope I'm not interrupting anything of importance. Your Excellency, would it be all right if I borrowed dear Artemis for a few moments?
By all means, this was an unproductive conversation to begin with.
Excellent! Come along now, Artemis, we don't have all day.
Yes, sir!
Wow, your mom's a fucking bitch. Knight Commander Grank casually strolled to the far side of the main hall, watching the bishop until she had left the room and was fully out of earshot. Artemis followed closely behind while fidgeting nervously.
Knight Commander? You're a very busy man. It would be irresponsible of me to take up too much of your time.
Alright guys, I'm gonna pause it right here. Man, this is really good. I love these character designs. Man, I can't wait to get further into this. Anyway, guys, thank you all so much for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, ring that notification bell, leave a super thanks or a tip if you can. It always helps. Until the next video, I love you all. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye!